go ahead and invite my friend Steve McCarthy to come and join me. And you guys have heard us talk about kingdom builders before, and kingdom builders for us is how we move the kingdom of God forward locally and globally and developing future leaders. And Steve is one of those global partners that works in the nation of Uruguay. And when I heard from Steve, we met, I think, at General Council last August, and we were waiting in line to pick up kids, and found out that Steve was a missionary to Uruguay, and we started talking, and he started to share with me the dream God's put in his heart. So from last year at August, I was like, I want Steve to come to Life Church. I want you to share what God's doing in Uruguay, and I want our hearts to be captivated by it. And this has been in the making for a little while, but would you guys give a big welcome to Steve McCarthy as he comes to share today?
Good morning. What a joy and delight to be with you today. How many know it's special when we get to gather together on a Sunday morning at church? We never know what service is going to be one that profoundly impacts our lives, but how many know it's not the one that we miss? And so I'm glad that you're here today. Thanks so much, Pastor Jason, for the opportunity to come and to share. It's so special anytime we're able to share what the Lord is doing in the nation of Uruguay. And so I'm very grateful for this opportunity today. Let me introduce you to my family real quick via a picture that I have. Then my beautiful wife, Jill, we got married 16 years ago. And we went on our honeymoon, as most people do. And then we did something most people do not do. 2 days after our honeymoon, we went out and interviewed to be missionaries. Few people told us we were crazy. They said, why would you do that? And the simple matter of fact is this. When we were teenagers, we sensed the call of God in our lives. And we thought, what better way to start our married life together than taking that step of faith together and being obedient to what he had called us to do? And so we went out to Springfield, and we interviewed to be missionaries. And I can remember at the time, the regional director for our area sat us down, and he shared with us about this incredible need in the nation of Uruguay. And to be honest, Jill and I, we didn't know too much about Uruguay at the time. So he opened this map and he showed us the country of Uruguay. It sits in South America right next to Argentina, just below Brazil. And he said something I'll never forget. He said, this is what we call the graveyard of Latin American missions. And then he asked this. He said, will you go and spend the rest of your lives there? And we kind of laugh about it now, but how many know it's a pretty serious question? Because then he said this. He said, 2 days later, we're meeting with the committee, and why don't you come back and give us your answer then? And so we had 48 hours to pray about this, but God spoke to our hearts during that time, and we came back and we said yes. And one of the amazing things that happened to us then was, Jason, your parents, who are sitting there right behind, they were our very first area directors for the Southern Cone there in South America. And so I just want to honor you and thank you for your leadership. You guys have been an incredible encouragement to us. It's one of the reasons why we are in and still serving in the nation of Uruguay. And so thanks so much for what you have meant down to all of us missionaries in the cone and the incredible investment you have made in that area of the world. We ended up going there. And since we've arrived, God's blessed us with three incredible kids. So we have Lucas. Lucas is 11, Joshua 8, and Julia 4. They love Jesus. They love being part of the ministry. And here's one of the interesting things as we're home this year itinerating. They actually ask us nearly every day, when are we going home? Because for them, Uruguay's home. And they can't wait to get back to their friends, their family, to the church, and to what's going on there in the country. In addition to our family growing, some of our responsibilities as far as ministry have grown as well, too. We teach at a Bible school, helping train the next generation of pastors and leaders there. We head up church planning for the Assemblies of God in the nation of Uruguay, helping to train and mentor young couples that feel the call of God on their lives. And one of the unique strategies that God has given us, because Uruguay is an atheistic country, typical outreaches that you might do in other places in Latin America don't necessarily work as well there. And so God gave us this unique strategy on using the sport of soccer. And soccer is one of my favorite sports. I played Division I in college here, spent some time over in Europe. And little did I know that God was preparing me through that sport to be able to reach the Uruguayans through one of their greatest passions. And so when we go into a new community to plant a new church, what we often do is we start a soccer club for kids first. Then as we get to know the families of these kids and then move into our small groups and our Sunday morning services, it's these children and their families that are the first to come and be part of these new works. And then this last term, as we started to see these new churches grow, we experienced a need for them to have the very first building. And so we moved into a season of construction, helping build the very first sanctuary for these congregations. And so we put together a little video to show you what that all looks like and some of the faces of the people who God is touching in the nation of Uruguay. Isn't God good? The people you saw in the video, those are new believers. Those are the new churches that have been planted. And those are the sanctuaries that you got to see, the very first building that this new congregation has had with their picture in front of it. And we're amazed at what God is doing in the country of Uruguay. You see, a few years ago, God gave us a vision, something we call Hope for Uruguay 100. And so the desire is to help plant or establish 100 new churches throughout the least reached parts of Uruguay and then build 100 sanctuaries for these new and growing congregations. And so I want to show you what God has done to date today. On the slide that you'll see here, 38 new churches have been planted. We've turned them all over to Uruguayan pastors. So they're led by them. They're all self-supporting, and each one of them is actively reaching their communities. In addition, in the last 4 years, 26 new churches have been built and dedicated, giving these new congregations their very first sanctuary, a place that they can call home. And as we're gathered here this morning, they are there worshiping the Lord, and it's a place where they can invite friends and family and neighbors to come and find him as well. Isn't God good? How many know, though, we continue, we desperately need your prayers as well. On the next slide, you'll see a picture of our new prayer card. It's got a picture of our family there. On your way out, I'd love to just hand you one of these. And if you would put it someplace where you would see it often and remember us and the people of Uruguay in your prayers, we would truly, truly appreciate that. And if you're interested, there's a little QR code there. Quarterly, we send out newsletters and updates, pictures, and videos of these new churches and some of the stories of the people that are coming to know Christ. Because how many know it's all about changed lives, right? This is a church that believes in missions. It's one that has an incredible heart for it. And so let me just say thank you. I could tell immediately from just coming in the great love that you have for the lost. And so on behalf of all the missionaries that you support here, thank you. On behalf of all the ministries that you partner with, thank you. I know if they were here today, they want to express their appreciation to you as well. And so your prayers, your encouragement, your generosity, help us to say yes to the call of God in our lives. Help us be able to take that step of faith and go where God has called us to go and see these lives changed, see families transformed, see new churches planted, and see God receive the glory. And so thanks for being a missions-minded church. You're having an incredible impact both in this nation and around the world. Now, this morning, I want to share a message with you that I've simply entitled, God and the Highly Unexpected. It's a story how someone unexpected, who's living in an unexpected place, through their obedience, they get to see God do some unexpected miracles. And so if you have your Bibles, would you open them? Turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 17. And I'm going to set this story up for you. There was a prophet named Elijah. Elijah lived in a difficult and a dark time. The king was named King Ahab. And here's how the Bible describes him. It says, he did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than any other king before him. Now, how many know there are some pretty bad kings of Israel? How bad do you have to be to gain the title of the king who did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than anyone else? And then you have his wife. I think Queen Jezebel might have been even worse than her husband. She was vile, manipulative. She turned the hearts of people from worshiping God to worshiping Baal. And she was actually known to have killed someone over a piece of property. So this is the setting. This is the day and age in which Elijah finds himself. And he's so upset because of what's taking place in his nation. He goes to the king and he announces it's not going to rain for the next 3 years. Now, how many know you better be sure you heard from God if you're going to go to the king and make an announcement like that? But he had. And then he goes to Kereth Ravine. God miraculously provides for him. He drinks water from the brook, bread and meat every day that ravens bring him so that he can eat morning and evening. But as you can imagine, no rain, no dew. Eventually, the brook dries up, and that's where our story picks up this morning. So 1 Kings chapter 17, I'll begin reading with verse 8. The word of the Lord came to him. Go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. So he went to Zarephath. And when he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? As she was going to get it, he called, and bring me, please, a piece of bread. As surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son that we may eat it and die. Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Go home. Do as you have said. But first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. And then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up. The jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land. She went away, did as Elijah has told her. And there's food every day for Elijah, the woman, and her family. What an incredible miracle. Can you imagine how desperate and hopeless this woman's situation must have been, and how in one day everything changed? You see, though, the greatest thing that happened to her wasn't just the fact that she had bread to eat for the days to come, but it was a realization she came to that day. There was a God in Israel that loved her, that cared about her, and that had a plan and purpose for her and for her family. And it couldn't have come at a better time. These were difficult and dark times, the corrupt leadership, the iniquity, the injustice, the idolatry, some of the very things that we still see in our world today. And yet, in spite of it, I love how God ends up choosing an unexpected person in an unexpected place. You see, God calls Elijah and he tells him to go to this unexpected woman who's living in this place called Zarephath. Now, Zarephath was the birthplace of Queen Jezebel, but it was also known as the epicenter of Baal worship in that nation. Of all the places God could have sent Elijah to, he chose this unexpected place called Zarephath. He could have chosen to send him to an affluent family. He could have chosen to send him to a community of believers. He could have chosen to send him to any other place, and yet he chooses this difficult and this dark area. You say, how bad could Baal worship really be? Here's some of the integral components: shrine prostitution, sexual immorality, and child and infant sacrifice. And yet that's the place where God sends him. I remember when Jill and I, we were first approved as missionaries. We were two unexpected people. We were newlyweds, just starting out, just trying to learn enough Spanish and understand enough culture to help share the gospel with some people in Uruguay. And we'd heard about the challenges there. We had heard about how unchurched the people were, how very secular it was, the great needs, a graveyard of Latin America. We had heard all these things, but I don't think the reality of the situation set in until we arrived and set foot in Uruguay. And I wonder if, as Elijah traveled to Zarephath that day, if he felt as uncomfortable as maybe Jill and I did in our early days in Uruguay, or maybe a new missionary does when they first set foot in their land of calling. But could it be that God still calls some unexpected people? And God still sends us to some unexpected places because there's lost people waiting to hear. Jill and I, we'd only been in Uruguay out 3 weeks. We headed to the northern part of the country to help with the church there. And I remember we're there and we get a call from our security company. They said our house had been robbed. I said, really? And they said, I'm thinking, we got the metal bars on the windows. We got the big wooden door, you know, and they kind of laughed. And they said, oh, you don't have a door anymore. They took an axe and chopped it down. So I said, all right. So we drive the 5 hours back to the capital city, and sure enough, no door. Our stuff's gone. But the biggest shock came a few days later when I realized who had robbed us. Would you believe they were neighbors? Squatters that had moved into an abandoned house 3 doors down and feed their drug habit, they go around and steal from everybody in our community. So guess what I did? I'm from New York. I took my axe. I chopped down their door. I took all my stuff back. No, I'm just joking. I didn't really do that. I took a soccer ball, sport that I love, one I know they love. I walked up their house, I knocked on the door, asked if they wanted to play. And they came out on the road in the middle of the street, dodging cars that day in the capital city, Montevideo. We played a soccer game. And it became something I do with them each week. And over time, they got to know me and they got to hear my story. Most important, they got to hear about Jesus. Fast forward 1 year, walking out of church one day, two teenage guys waiting for me at the door. I said, hey, Steve, you remember who we are? I said, yeah, you're my neighbors. I told them their names. They said, guess what? We just got saved this week. We came to this church here because there's a teen challenge or drug and alcohol rehab center. We're trying to get off drugs and get our lives straightened out. They said, would you go and tell our family we're safe, we're okay, we haven't had contact with them in the last few days? And I said, absolutely. They said, I even had the privilege of going to their home. Remember that door I wanted to knock down? This time they opened it for me. And I walked in, I got to share with their whole family about Jesus. As I was leaving that day, I glanced to see if maybe my TV was mounted on their wall or any of Jill's shoes were over in the corner. But I realized something that day. God was more concerned with the spiritual condition of my neighbor's heart than he was with my comfort or my possessions. And sometimes God allows us to go through difficult seasons in life to create opportunities so that lost neighbors or family members or friends or coworkers have a chance to know him. Could it be that God still calls some unexpected people? And he still sends us to some unexpected places because there's lost people that need to hear about him. It wasn't too long ago, I was sharing at a church in Uruguay. We had wrapped up the service. A young man comes to me at the front during the altar time. He says, Steve, I don't know why, but as you were sharing today, God spoke to my heart that I need to plant a church. I said, great, let's talk to your pastor. And so we began to talk with him. His pastor got super excited. He said, just 3 years ago, he wandered into our church for the very first time. Never been to church in his life before, but something through a radio station had sparked his interest in God, and he came to our church to ask as he wanted to know more. And over those 3 years, God had just done this incredible work in his heart. And so the pastor said, absolutely, let's help him plant a church. And so we have this year-long training and mentorship program where we walk through the process and we help young couples that have never pastored before establish their first church. And so we did it with them in this community. And then comes the second part. We challenge this new congregation that they have to buy their first property. And then we come alongside and we help them build their first sanctuary. And so they got all excited with the help of that mother church. They bought their property. We went and we built. And they're actually church number 9 in the Hope for Uruguay 100 project. In fact, their picture was one of those you saw in the video with the congregation in front of their new building. And at the dedication, Marcelo said something I'll never forget. He said, Steve, I'm an unexpected person. I'm the least likely in this community that people would have thought would have ever gotten saved, let alone become a pastor. I'm an unexpected person in an unexpected place. Yet because of the transforming power of God, my life is different, and I have an opportunity to share that good news with those around me. Another person I think of is Sergio. Sergio was part of the occult, living on the street. One day walked by one of our churches. Warm summer day, windows were open, and he heard the pastor preaching on the Holy Spirit. He'd never been to church before. He didn't really know the protocol or what happens. In fact, he didn't even walk in the front door. He just kind of walked up to the window, leaned on it, and poked his head in that day. At one point, he's got a question. He doesn't know you don't interrupt the pastor when they're preaching. So he just kind of raises his hand. He says, excuse me, sir, who's this Holy Spirit you're talking about? I've invited every other spirit I've ever heard of to come and live inside of me. I've never heard of the Holy Spirit before. That was the day Sergio gave his life to Christ. God set him free in a powerful way. He ends up coming to our Bible school. He was one of our students there. He's a pastor of a church, church number 13 that we built in the Hope for Uruguay 100 project. If he were here with us this morning, I wonder if he might just say something like this to us. I'm an unexpected person, serving in an unexpected place. Yet because of what God's done in my life, I get to share that hope of forgiveness, grace, mercy, and salvation with those around me. You see, God still calls some unexpected people, and he still sends us to some unexpected places because there's lost people waiting to hear. And the amazing thing about God is he wants to use you, and he wants to use me. He's called each of us to be his witnesses, to share with family and friends and neighbors and coworkers and classmates. The question is, are we willing? Are we willing to do what he's asked us to do? Are we willing to pray and give and go and share? Are we willing to do our part in helping one more person find him? The amazing thing is this. When we say yes, great stuff happens. Lives are changed. Families are transformed. New churches are planned. And God receives the glory. A few years ago, there was a couple in northern Uruguay named Marcelo and Cecilia. They were sitting in a church service like this, and their pastor shared about a community 100 kilometers away that had never had a church before. No Catholic church, no Protestant church. And even though they had never served in ministry before, something struck their hearts that day as they sat in service. They came to the pastor at the end, and they said, we're willing to go. They quit their jobs as teachers, they sold their home, and they moved with their 3 children to this new community to plant the very first church ever there. And I think the reality of the situation set in about 2 days later, because that's when I got the call from Marcelo. He said, Steve, we don't know what we're doing. Can you come and help us plant a church? And we said, absolutely. And they became part of that year-long training and mentorship program. And we walked the process with them. As I shared earlier, one of our strategies is to use the sport of soccer. And so we started a soccer club there for kids, and we started to see some inroads in the community. And then we ran a tournament for the men of that community. And there was a great response that day. They came with their teams, they competed, and we ended with this huge barbecue, something called an asado. And if you like steak, you know, that area of the world just has some incredible beef down there. I think recently they said in Uruguay, we consume more red meat per capita than any other nation in the world, right? 8 cows per person. So the steak's plentiful. They throw on the grill the chorizo sausages, this queso parmigiano, it's the provolone cheese, it's melted the oregano on there. And so you got this huge spread. And at the end, as they're just finishing eating, we share the gospel message with these men. Many of them respond and gave their lives to Christ. And later when we launched that church, they were the ones who brought their families. And then we challenged them. You buy the property, we'll help you build. And they got excited. But they said, it can't be any property. It's got to be one in the center of town where everyone's going to see it. It's got to be something visible because this will be the first church that we've ever had in our community here. And they bought this beautiful, it's this corner lot. We went and built church number 4 in the Hope for Uruguay 100 project. And for the next 5 months, everything was going well. Church was growing, making inroads in the community. Suddenly, one morning, I had a call from Cecilia. She said, Steve, something happened in Marcelo. Something was hard. He just transported to the hospital, and a week later, he died. I still remember that call. She said, why would God have us leave our jobs and our family and our church to move to this new community, to plant a church just for my husband to die? And we walked through the process with her and her 3 kids. And along the way, Cecilia came to this realization. She said, maybe God didn't just call my husband, but he called our whole family here. And she said, I'm willing to stay and assume the role of the pastor. And along with the help of her 3 children, they've done an incredible job. The church has tripled in size. She's actually been able to leave a teaching job in that community and come on full time as the pastor of that church. I wonder if she was here with us this morning, if she might say something like this. I'm an unexpected person in an unexpected place. And yet because she was willing to stay, even during a difficult time, God's used her and her family to make an eternal difference in that community. You see, there was another person, an unexpected person like Cecilia, who happened to be a widow. One we read about in 1 Kings today. And you see, here she was, a single mom, a Gentile. If you remember when she looked at Elijah, she didn't say our God, she said your God. Most likely she was a Baal worshiper living in the heart of darkness in the middle of a famine, just trying to find enough sticks to make a fire and have a final meal with her son. You can imagine how hopeless it must have been, how unexpected she was. And who knows what thoughts were going through Elijah's mind as he walked there that day and he saw her humble situation and he saw what was going on and he wondered, can this person really provide for my needs? And yet in the midst of that, he makes an interesting request. First, he asked for water. That's common. That's acceptable culture. But then he asked for a piece of bread. And then she began to think, I don't have any bread. I don't have the ingredients to make bread. I don't have the resources to buy bread. I can't do this. It's impossible. How can I really help this stranger when my family has such a great need? And I wonder if sometimes if we fall in a similar pattern of thinking. We get overwhelmed with the needs that we have. As a family, as a country, we look at the different things that are going around the world, and maybe you're like me, you look at the gravity and enormity of the problem, we say, can we really make that much of a difference? Maybe I'll just keep what I have rather than using what God's placed in my life. But you see, God doesn't ever ask us to solve the whole problem. He just asks us to do the part he wants us to play in it. And when we're willing and faithful to say yes and begin to use what he's placed in our hand, we can trust him to do some incredible things. And I love that she's willing to do that. You see, we have an unexpected person in an unexpected place, but we also have an unexpected plan. Elijah says to her, but first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have. Bring it to me and then make something for you and your son. Yikes, that's pretty bold. Make something first for me, the stranger that just showed up. And then if you have anything left for you and your son. Remember, this is no ordinary person. This is the same guy who announces to the king it's not going to rain. This is the same guy who after this takes on 450 prophets of Baal on top of Mount Carmel and challenges them to a showdown to see who the true God of Israel is. How was he so confident in all of these situations? Could it be simply this? He knew the voice of God, and he trusted it. So whether it was God telling him to go and announce to the king it's not going to rain, or take on the prophets of Baal, or simply what he said to him in verse 9, go to Zarephath, I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. The plan was unlikely, the strategy was unexpected, and yet it worked. There ends up being enough ingredients to make bread for her son, and for Elijah. I'm glad there was a widow there that was willing to do her part. I wonder, have we ever missed out on a miracle from God just because we weren't willing to do what he asked us to do? Jill and I, we nearly did. God had spoken to us about Hope for Uruguay 100, plant 100 churches, build 100 churches. And we had moved forward with the planting, but we got to that part of the construction and we really didn't have much experience with this at all. And so we partnered with an organization called Builders International to be able to move forward on this. And they said, Steve, don't worry, we got you. We're going to send some people down to Uruguay. They can assess your situation. They'll find the most cost-effective strategy, the way you can build using local resources and materials. Not only that, we got a legacy team of people, pastors and businessmen that want to invest in projects like this. We'll give you the seed offerings to get your project off the ground. And finally, they said, we got 12 teams from the States that want to come down and build your first 12 churches in Uruguay. Seemed pretty good. We picked the optimal moment to launch, March of 2020. Remember what happened then? 2 days before this group was supposed to arrive, everything changed. Our borders closed, schools couldn't meet, churches weren't allowed to, government buildings, everything just changed. And looking at the financial crisis and the health crisis that gripped the world, Jill and I said, is it really the right time to launch an initiative of this magnitude? And yet, God's word that people are valuable to him and their situation didn't change because of a pandemic just continued to ring in our hearts. And we didn't quite know how. The group never came to tell us how to build. We didn't have any of those resources. We didn't have any teams. But we just knew we were supposed to take a step of faith and trust God. And so we did. Drove up with our Speedlight vehicle, a trailer on the back with some resources and materials and equipment I thought I would need. I wasn't quite sure. I thought we might need them with the construction. And I had this audacious goal to build a church in a week. 6 days and dedicate it on the seventh day. And so we show up church number one community called Flor de Maronas in the capital of Montevideo. They've been meeting under a tent for the last 3 years there. And we decide we're going to start building. September 2020. And here we are. I recognize everybody that was there except one gentleman. I asked him his name. He says, Antonio. I say, Antonio, how'd you end up here today? And he starts out like this. He says, just so you know, I'm an atheist. First thing he says to me, just so you know, I'm an atheist. Never been to church before, he says. But my wife just started to come. He goes, I'm a retired construction worker, love to lay brick, heard you were working, and thought I'd come and help you out for the day. I said, great, you're working with me. And so we started on the wall over here together, and we began to build. And I realized very quickly, Antonio knew what he was doing. That was important because I had no idea what I was doing. And we began to talk throughout the day, and at the end of the day, I said to him, I said, Antonio, you've been such a blessing today. Would you consider coming back tomorrow? We could really use your help again. And he said, sure. Not only did he come back a second day, a third, a fourth, a fifth, and a sixth. We get done with the sixth day, and somehow the church got built. And we were preparing for the dedication the following day, and I looked at him and I said, Antonio, we would love to honor you. You've been here all week helping us. Would you consider coming back tomorrow for our celebration? He said, I don't know. I've never been to church before, but I'll think about it. But guess who came the next day? And when I gave the altar call at the end of the service, guess who walked down the middle aisle to the front to give his life to Christ? But Antonio didn't come alone that day. He brought his kids and his grandkids to the altar with him. He said, Steve, all their lives I told them God didn't exist. But this week I sensed his presence for the first time, and I realized my need for him in my life. And so I wanted my kids and my grandkids to come to the altar with me so they could see me place my faith in him. Later, when he was baptized, many of his kids and grandkids were baptized that very same day with him. And he said this. He said, Steve, thank you for coming and changing the course of my family history. And I looked at him, I said, Antonio, I didn't do that. God did. But I realized something. I think I know what he meant. Our obedience opens the door for lives to be changed. Our willingness to say yes to God positions us to see miracles like this take place. Our willingness to say, I will go to unexpected people in unexpected places in unexpected ways opens the door for lives to be changed and families to be transformed. And so let me thank you for being a church that cares about reaching lost people, for being one that prioritizes helping families find Jesus, for being one that helps people both locally and globally to know the good news of Jesus Christ. Wrapping up this story, I love that the widow was willing to use what she had, not out of her abundance, but just out of the little that she had left. Now, I'm not exactly sure when she realized something miraculous was taking place. Could it be when she grabbed that jar of flour and it felt a little heavier than it should have been? Could it be when she grabbed that jug of oil and began to pour some out and more sloshed out than should have been in there? Could it have been after she made that first piece of bread for Elijah and looked back in there and she said, could it be that there's still some flour and there's still some oil? But somewhere along the way, she realized something supernatural is taking place. A smile spread across her face. Not just because she was going to have bread to eat that day, but because she came to the realization that there was a God in Israel that loved her, that cared about her, and that had a plan and purpose for her and for her family. The needs of this poor woman were not insignificant to God, but he sent Elijah to her, an unexpected person, in an unexpected place, in an unexpected way, at just the right time when she felt completely lost and hopeless. And I love what happened. A completely unexpected result occurred. Her obedience and her generosity opened the door to the miraculous. Aren't you glad we serve a God like that? A God who still calls out and cries out for lost people. A God who still makes a way. A God who still is seeking people to say yes, to go to some unexpected places and some unexpected people. The question is, are we willing? Are we willing to say yes? Are we willing to go? Are we willing to pray? Are we willing to give? Are we willing to sacrifice? You see, God wants to use you and God wants to use me. Unexpected people in unexpected places to do some unexpected things. And we can trust him to do his part and we'll get to see some unexpected miracles along the way. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me today? Heavenly Father.